or anything, I'm afraid to move.
Oh, we're just recording.
Oh, Cassidy, happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
We can crop it, right?
Crop it.
Are we? We are recording, though.
Right? Yeah,
we're recording.
We're recording. But
oh, awesome!
He's gonna have to crop it.
Some comedy relief.
Well, good morning, church, and good morning, you guys that made it through the snow. We're very excited to be here. Even if it was just us, we would be very excited to be worshiping the Lord wherever you are this morning, especially if you're home. I hope you're safe and you're tuning in. We're going to worship together. The weather actually kind of feels good, so it gives us more hope and more joy to worship our King. So if you would stand up if you're here, or if you would tune in if you're home, we'll be worshiping together. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for your wonderful grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you for being good, even when the weather doesn't seem so good. Thank you for your presence, and I pray that you talk to us this morning and you give us your message this morning, and just show us your love as you always do. We love you and we want to worship you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again, for your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. You will do great things.
Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, unshakable. Hallelujah. done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh, God, you do great things.
Amen. Good morning. I tell you, I'm glad that we can come and celebrate Christ together. I know many of you ventured out here, and we are glad that you're here with us. If you're joining us online, we're thankful for that also. But we want to welcome you to Olivet. We're about loving God and belonging in community, making disciples, and reaching the world. And we're glad that you've connected with us in this way. Now, you know, there's a the weather and all this kind of stuff happening the Christmas season, which is kind of an exciting thing as we think about Christmas. But there's also a lot of stuff that'll be happening. Just want to let you know about even this week. Wednesday night, for instance, at 6 o'clock, we'll have our quarterly business meeting, our 2021 budget presentation. Also that evening is going to be our student Christmas celebration. Their party will be in the Family Life Center starting at 6 o'clock, so you want to be a part of that time. And then also this weekend is going to be a unique celebration of Christmas. It's going to be called Holiday Wishes, and it's basically a 10-minute video that really celebrates, I would say, our cultural traditions about Christmas. And then at the close, it's really a powerful presentation of the gospel and why we celebrate Christmas and what it means. And that's going to be actually Friday, Saturday, and Sunday evening from 5:30 to 8. And then on Saturday morning, we're going to have Christmas with the Grinch with our children. That will be from 9 to 11 down in the Family Life Center. And then next Sunday, you don't want to miss it. We're going to sing Christmas songs. Your family have an opportunity to take pictures together, and we're going to share together in the Lord's Supper. And there will also be a hot chocolate bar. So listen, you don't want to miss next week. It's going to be a great time to celebrate Christmas this year, and so be a part of that. So again, we're going to continue our worship time. I appreciate our worship team and this time that we can celebrate Christ. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you, Father, that in the midst of even this snowy weather, in the midst of an unusual year, in the midst kind of all the different things that have impacted all of us in so many different ways, God, that you are our foundation. You are consistent. You've kept your promise to us at Christmas. And God, I pray that we would rest in you. May we find our strength, peace, and hope in you. In Jesus' name.
There is a light that burns in the darkness. There is a hope that washes the fear away. There is a peace that settles around us. It is your love that sets our hearts ablaze. There is a light that burns through the darkness. There is a hope that washes the fear away. There is a peace that settles around us. There is a love that sets our hearts ablaze. Father, we're on our knees with every heartbeat we hear. bring you this offering. Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're crying out. Spirit, we need you now. Glorious love surrounds us. Lord, come and fill this place. There is a King that reigns in victory. There is a mercy strong enough to save. We feel it rising up from the ashes. There is a love that overcame the grave.
There is a love that overcame the grave. So Father, we're on our knees. With every heartbeat we bring you this offering. Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're crying out. Spirit, we need you now. Glorious love surrounds us. Lord, come and fill this place.
And I will worship you. I worship you. Worship you always, and I will worship you. I worship you. I worship you always, and I will worship you. I worship you. I worship you always, and I will worship you. I will worship you. I worship you always,
and I will worship you. I worship you. Worship you always, and I will worship you. I worship you. I worship you always. Father, we're on our knees with every heartbeat. We bring you this offering. So Lord, come and fill this place. And Father, we're crying out. Spirit, we need you now. Glorious love surrounds us. Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're on our knees. With every heartbeat we bring you this offering. So Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're crying out. Spirit, we need you now. Glorious love surrounds us. Lord, come and fill this place. Lord, come and fill this place.
God, we're so thankful for you this morning. We're so thankful for the joy we can have in Jesus. We're so thankful that we can say, Lord, come and fill this place with your presence, with your mercy, with your grace, and that you actually come. We're so thankful that one day, thousands of years ago, you sent your son down as a baby so he could bring us joy, so he could bring us hope, so he could bring us back to you.
We want to worship that King, the baby Jesus, forever, our Savior. Just help us worship you better. Help us live our life better for you. Help us live closer to you in a relationship with you in a way that we can worship and say every morning, oh, come, let us adore the King of Kings that was King of Kings that was born as a baby to save us. We want to worship you this morning and forever. In Jesus' name I pray.
For the unholy, for the world, the unworthy you came. Jesus, you came for the wounded, for the hurting, for the lost, for the lonely you came. Jesus, you came.
Come all ye faithful, before our Savior, come let us adore the one who came for us. In glory in the highest, praise the name of Jesus. Our King is
this love, God. Again, we want to sing this praise to you forever. Thank you for sending your Son for us. Thank you that we can celebrate the baby Jesus this month and hopefully for the rest of our lives. Thank you that we can praise you and shout out saying, hallelujah, our King has come. Our Savior has come. We're not lost anymore. We're not going to be away from you forever anymore because our King has come. We worship you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning. I tell you, I'm thankful for those who are able to brave the weather and be here this morning in person. We're also thankful for those who are meeting with us online. And so this morning, if you have your Bibles, if you would open them to Luke chapter 2. Little bit of excitement. All right. I can hear it in online land out there. Luke chapter 2. We're going to continue our series called The Advent Conspiracy. And I just want to ask you a question. I think it's a relevant question for all of us who are followers of Jesus. And it is this question. If you're a follower of Jesus, does the way you spend your time, your money, and your energy during Christmas reflect the honoring of Jesus at Christmas? I mean, I think that's an important question for us to ask. I mean... Today, as we continue this series, The Advent Conspiracy, it's all about this idea that you know, there's this conspiring against the way our culture has kind of taken over Christmas. And really, in the same time, missed the meaning and purpose of Christmas, that we as followers of Jesus, in a good way, would take it back to restore really what the message of Christmas is about. Now, this title or this idea is certainly not original with me. In fact, I first heard it from another pastor, and then about 10 years ago, a little over 10 years ago, Rick McKinley, Chris Say, and Greg Holder started what they called the Advent Conspiracy. And basically what it was, the idea was that there had to be a better and fuller and richer way to celebrate the joy of Christmas than what the typical American family celebrated Christmas, and even the Christian family. In other words, that it should be more about giving than it is about receiving. Now, I thought about that, and I thought the truth is, even at OBC, this concept is not new for us. We celebrated even this year by giving shoeboxes to Operation Christmas Child, which gives gifts to some children in the greatest areas of need on this planet while sharing the gospel. We also had the privilege just yesterday of being a part of Christmas Joy, and I'm thankful so many in our church family. I mean, in the midst of this very unusual year and even the past several weeks, our folks gave sacrificially gifts, and we were able to be a part of blessing really over 100 families just yesterday in our community with Christmas gifts and also sharing the gospel. But also this Christmas season, we have the opportunity to be a part of the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Now, some people think that is just a debt that the church has every year that we're trying to pay something off. It's really not. It's a great opportunity for us to give above and beyond our tithe to international missions. In fact, when we give to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, 100% of what you give goes to missions and mission needs around the world. And what a privilege. I mean, if you think about it, right here where we live, your life and my life, we can literally make an impact for the gospel around the world. And a part of that is the goal is to make Christmas meaningful again. Because how many of us over the years have missed the wonder of God's miraculous birth, and we do so with an overstuffed December, leaving you more exhausted than you are excited about Jesus? Or if you buy into this hyper-consumption mentality that ultimately ends up leaving you empty. I mean, if we're not careful, at Christmas we worship less and we spend more and we give less and we struggle more. And sadly for many people, when you talk about the Christmas season, it is a very difficult time. It is a high-stress time. It is a time of anxiety, a time of remembering loved ones that they've lost, feelings of despair. And instead of being hopeful, sadly, many people find this season in which they feel hopeless. So today, I want to take just a few minutes, and I want us to reclaim the Christmas message by reminding each of us in this room and those listening that you and I have been given a gift of hope. Now, I'm asking you a question. Have you ever been given a gift that you did not need or could not use? It may be that string of ties that sits in your closet. It might even be that, man, maybe you are a diehard fisherman, and you're probably not super excited even if you get a cool set of golf clubs, which I can't really relate to that. But on the flip side, I mean, if you're a golfer and you get a brand new reel, I mean, I'd have to admit that wouldn't be super exciting for me either. I mean, that's just kind of how it goes. Well, what I would say to you is at Christmas, I want you and I to remember that we have been given a gift of hope that actually meets the deepest needs of your life and mine. In fact, it's one of these needs that you have, and you may not even always realize you have it, but it is this need for hope in the midst of all that is going on, and regardless of your circumstances, regardless of your fear, regardless of the craziness of this year, the truth is we have been given a gift of unchanging hope. And that's really what Christmas was about. In fact, in Luke chapter 2, beginning in verse 8, we see at the very first Christmas, it says, "In the same region, shepherds were staying out in the fields and keeping watch at night over their flock. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Don't be afraid, for look, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the city of David, a Savior was born for you, who is the Messiah. He is the Christ, the Lord. This will be the sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped tightly in cloth lying in a manger.' Suddenly there was a multitude of heavenly hosts with the angel praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to people he favors.'" Now, to me, when you read that, you can just feel the joy. You can feel the excitement. You can feel the anticipation of the angels and the shepherds. Because this Christmas message is the keeping of a promise, the truth of a Messiah. God's promised one is coming, and he offers us hope. And I would just encourage you, don't miss that this year. In fact, maybe more than any year in recent memory, you and I need to be reminded of that hope. We need to grab hold of that hope, because no matter what situation you find yourself in, there is hope. In fact, you might read it again. Notice Luke chapter 2 there in your outline. Notice what the angel said. "And the angel said to them, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord.'" So I would just remind you, there is hope. So number one, we're going to kind of play this out. The first thing to remember is that there is hope in doubt. Now, I thought about if there's ever probably a season of months that we've lived through this year that could create doubt, my guess is it might be now. I mean, you know, there's been struggles, fears about our health, fears about our job, our finances. I mean, I got to be honest with you. There's things that have happened this year that if you would have asked me a year ago, could that possibly happen? I would say, no way. I mean, there's just no way it could happen, some of the things that have happened this year. And sometimes that creates doubt. But here's the thing to remember. The truth is all of us have doubts. Most Christians struggle with doubts, and some even feel guilty about their doubts. You know why? Because there is a brand of Christianity out there that says, hey, don't ever doubt. And if you do, God's angry with you. I mean, you know, if you ever have doubts about God, or maybe you're angry with God about something, or something didn't turn out right, and then all of a sudden, you know, if you express that to God, he is angry with you. Now, listen, I'm going to let you in on a secret. If you're angry with God or you have doubts about God, here's something. He already knows. He's not shocked. I mean, God's sovereign. He already knows it. And here's the truth. We all have doubts, and I want to encourage you to bring them to God. We've said this at OBC over and over and over, and I'm going to say it again. There is no question you can't bring to God. If you have doubts, I don't care what that issue is, God can handle it. And we, you know, I always say, feel free to send an email. It doesn't mean I know the answer, but we can look for the answer, because the biblical worldview has stood the test of time, and it will continue to do so. So the truth of the matter is, there are doubts we can bring to God. Now, when you have doubts that are looking for answers, your faith will grow exponentially. Now, I would warn you, I think there is a brand of false faith out there that acts as if, well, the most spiritual thing you can do is to doubt and question. And so basically what you need to do is have questions that lead to more questions that lead to unbelief because you really don't want an answer. I mean, there's a really great guy that I've met with, I had lunch with three times a few years ago because he had questions. And so we talked about things the first time we met. And then we had lunch again a second time, and there were other questions. And then the third time we met, I came to this realization that the truth is he did not want answers. He just simply wanted more questions. He just didn't want to believe. Now, what I'm saying is this. If you will bring your doubts to God seeking answers, what you're going to find is that he is sufficient. The fact is we all have doubts at times, even about important things. I mean, I heard the story that there was a minister that was in the middle of a wedding. Just before he was about to perform the wedding, he asked that traditional question, is there anyone here who knows any reason these two should not be joined in matrimony? And a voice rang out to the shock of the audience, and a man said, I do. And the pastor quickly said, be quiet, you're the groom, you dummy. Well, folks, you know, the truth of the matter, we all battle doubts, sometimes even about big things. I mean, maybe you have doubts about yourself or doubts about your abilities or doubts about life, doubts even about God. What I would say to you is at Christmas, God has proven you can trust him. He has kept his promise. He has provided a road for a relationship with him. I mean, in Genesis chapter 1, we know that God is the creator of the universe. He created you and all that we see. Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve sinned, and the human race was plunged into spiritual darkness. Our sin had separated us from God, and we inherited a sin nature. At that moment, the single greatest problem the world will ever face arose, and it's sin. I mean, that is the biggest problem, but we also know from Genesis 3 that at that moment, God made a promise that would solve that problem. He would send a Savior who would take care of our sin problem. And what we're celebrating at Christmas is that God has kept his promise. And that brings us back really to what we read in Luke chapter 2. If you think about it, there's angels all over the Christmas story. It was an angel that told Joseph that Mary was going to conceive a child birthed by the Holy Spirit. It was an angel that told Mary she was to become the mother of the Son of God. And it is an angel speaking to some shepherds out in a field. Again, notice Luke 2, verse 10. But the angel said to them, don't be afraid, for look, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. That'll be for all the people. What is this good news, and why should it bring great joy? That even those shepherds, they didn't quite get it. And if you think about it, even the disciples, they spent 3 years with Jesus. I'm not sure they quite understood it until they realized that he was raised powerfully from the dead. And when they locked eyes with the resurrected Christ, they began to understand the message of the gospel, and that is that God keeps his promise. The Messiah has risen from the dead. For thousands of years, the Jewish people have been looking for the Messiah. They've been looking for a Savior. They kept looking because God made a promise. And at Christmas, God kept it. So if you doubt that God keeps his promises, notice this, 2 Corinthians 1:20. For all of God's promises have been fulfilled in Christ. So that is the picture. You know, if you've never read Pilgrim's Progress, in fact, it's a Christian classic. And if you're a reader, I hope you'd take time to read it. It's John Bunyan's great allegory of the Christian life. In fact, it is the story of a character by the name of Christian. And Christian is on this journey that he takes from his hometown, which is called the City of Destruction, which is this world, to the celestial city, which represents heaven. And as he goes, he faces these great problems. Some of them we're even dealing with in this message today. But in this story, Christian falls asleep in a field belonging to a giant by the name of Despair. Well, the giant takes them into Doubting Castle, where he puts them in a dark and stinking dungeon without any food or water. Well, he beats them mercilessly and then suggests that they commit suicide. Well, after the giant leaves, Christian is talking to his friend Hopeful about what they ought to do. Well, finally, Christian remembers a key in his pocket, and here's what he says. He says, I have a key in my bosom called Promise that will, I am persuaded, open any lock in Doubting Castle. Surely enough, it opened all the doors in the castle, even the gate, and the narrative closes with these words, then they went on and came to the king's highway. See, what I would say is even if you are here this time of year and this season of your life and you're struggling with doubt, I mean, you may be doubting about whether God loves you. You may doubt about whether there's a real purpose for your life. You may be doubting about whether or not you can find a way around the struggles that you're facing. They may seem so big, you can't find a way around them. I would just remind you of this. In the midst of all those doubts, stop at Christmas and remember this child in a manger is God keeping his promise. God meeting your deepest need and my deepest need. By sending his son, he took care of the biggest problem that you and I will ever face. And so in the midst of your doubts, let me encourage you, don't run from them. Don't be afraid of them. Bring them to God, because he can handle it. He gives us hope in doubt. But number two, there's a second truth. He gives us hope in despair. Now, there's an interesting phrase, and we've read it a few times. What do they say? They say, you know, we ought to rejoice because what? God has given us a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Now, have you ever thought about how unusual that word is? I mean, you think about it. In the common language we use, do you use the term Savior in just interaction? It's a very unusual word. And the question I would ask was, well, why do we need a Savior? Well, he says it's this good news to all people. This means everyone. It means Muslims, Hindus, Jews, Gentiles. It means people you like, people that you don't like. It means people of every race. And what does it mean? You and I need a Savior. Why is that the case? Now listen, it is because the universal problem that every human being has on this planet is sin. We mentioned it earlier. We have a sin nature. Now, I hope you hear what I'm saying, because I think even a lot of churches have kind of missed this focus. The biggest problem we have today, it's not injustice, it's not oppression, it's not lust, it's not pride. Those are the result of the problem. The problem is that we are sinners. We are sinners by nature, by choice. We're broken. We need a Savior. We need someone to change our hearts. In fact, what I'm going to say is a little bit countercultural, because the truth is, you know, the truth is simply this. You are the major reason you have most of your problems, and I'm the major reason that I have most of my problems. Now, let me clarify. I understand there may be other people who contribute to some of the problems, and there may be circumstances that play, but let's be honest. I think if we look at ourselves, we realize that all of us, we have habits that you ought to break, thoughts that you shouldn't think, emotions that you shouldn't feel, resentments that you can't let go of, and say things that you shouldn't say. Now, if anyone's going to say, hey, that's not me, then listen, you're unusual. Because that's the picture. We know these things are wrong, and yet we keep doing them. Our inclination is to do things our way instead of God's way. And we're all born with this tendency to do the wrong things instead of the right things. And that is called sin. It's a sin nature. So over the years, you know, I've met people who want to act like they're perfect, or maybe they think they're perfect, but they would never publicly admit that they think they're perfect. I mean, you know, it wouldn't be something we'd say. And today, because of our culture, a lot of people don't like the concept of sin or the fact that we're sinners. But I think if we're honest and take a look at ourselves, we know that there's this brokenness in us. In fact, if you'll notice Isaiah 59, the prophet put it this way. He says, it's your sins that have cut you off from God. Because of your sins, he has turned away and will not listen anymore. Spurgeon in a sermon, and I'm going to paraphrase, put it this way. He said, you know, next time you're really offended by what someone says to you or someone has hurt you and you think, man, they are so selfish. They are so, you know, self-centered. Can you believe their motives and who they are? Next time you go that route, he said, first of all, stop and take a look at your own heart. And then begin to examine what's going on there and realize that we also need God's help. I mean, I don't know that I've ever seen a time of greater despair at large in our nation. I mean, there is more worry and fear and desperation and depression and suicide and emptiness. It's almost, man, we need a way out, someone to reach down and help us. And there's only one person who can do that. That is the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, a Savior who is Christ the Lord. That's why the Bible talks about that we can be brought from spiritual death to life. We're born again. This baby born in a manger lived a perfect life, died a perfect death, paid for the sins of all mankind. He provided a way of escape. He offers forgiveness, a fresh start. He offers you today new life. He offers you a new beginning, regardless of your past, regardless of your failures. You can literally, as I said, be born again, be brought from spiritual death to spiritual life. In fact, I love the way this is paraphrased in the Living Bible. 2 Corinthians 5:21, it says, for God took the sinless Christ and poured into him our sins. Then in exchange, he poured God's goodness into us. Man, that's one of those passages you need to hold on to and memorize. One pastor, James Merritt, put it this way. He said, there are two words you will hear this season more than Merry Christmas or Happy Holidays, and it's these two words, charge it. That's what you'll hear more. And he said, yet that is exactly what God did. He charged all of our sins upon Jesus. He placed them upon the sinless Christ, and Jesus took our place. He took our sin. And when we place our trust in him, we literally exchange our sin for Christ's righteousness. I mean, that's a heck of a deal. I mean, that is the picture of what God offers through this baby born in a manger. So we have hope in doubt. We have hope in despair. And lastly, the last thought is this. We have hope even in death. We have hope even in death. You know, as a pastor, I've conducted hundreds of funerals, been a part of hundreds of funerals. And I can tell you there is a palatable difference of speaking at a funeral when you have someone who has no evidence that they've ever known Christ, as opposed to someone who knows Jesus and has lived for Jesus, and everyone in the room kind of knows, you know, their testimony and who they are. I mean, there's an amazing, I mean, you can almost just feel the difference. And it really makes sense to me. I mean, the reason it is because, listen, death from a purely human perspective is hopeless. I mean, think of it. I mean, without Jesus, death is 100% hopeless. There was a survey done a few years ago that found that even the average American, the modern American, and all of our technology, the number one fear of most Americans, the fear of death. I mean, it's just one of those things you cannot escape. And it's amazing to remind you that if what the angels said and sang in that shepherd's field 2,000 years ago is true, then we no longer have to fear death. Because one of the reasons that Jesus came was to conquer death, hell, and the grave, and he did so through his death, burial, and resurrection. That's why when you place your trust in him, his righteousness is poured into you, and you now don't have to live with the fear of death. In fact, notice the way the writer of Hebrews puts it. It says, because God's children are human beings, made of flesh and blood, the Son also became flesh and blood, for only as a human being could he die, and only by dying could he break the power of the devil, who had the power of death. Only in this way could he set free all who have lived their lives as slaves to the fear of dying. In other words, when we place our faith in Christ and what he's done, that fear can be replaced with hope. I mean, this baby born in a manger lived and died and rose from the dead. And when you place your trust in him, let me tell you what happens. He gives you this sense of peace. I mean, some of you know my story. I really wasn't raised in a church background. And over time, I had a friend that shared the gospel with me. And I tell you, one of the things when I received Christ that began to really become a part of my life was there was this sense of peace between me and God. I don't know how else to put it. I mean, there was just like something had been settled. And it's amazing what happens when you know that you are at peace with God, that you're right with God and he's right with you. Let me tell you what happens. It begins to overflow in your life. And now all of a sudden, you can be at peace with others. Because one of the byproducts of walking in God's presence is his peace. And then his peace overflows into your relationship with others. Now, I know that's a difficult time for me to say this, because at Christmas, for some, it's tough. Some of you may have relatives that you don't particularly want to speak to, or maybe you haven't talked to, and things are difficult, and you've got these unresolved issues. I would simply say this, if you're a follower of Jesus, and you're at peace with God, I would encourage you to do all that you can do to be at peace with others. It's one of these great gifts that the Savior has given us. As we think of this baby in the manger, he is the greatest gift of all. The gift of Jesus is the most expensive gift you'll ever receive. It's priceless. He is the only gift you will ever receive that will last forever. And that he is a gift you can rely on every day for the rest of your life. That's why we have hope. James Dobson tells the story of when his son was like 3 or 4 years old, that he was out in the front yard and he was playing, and in their driveway they had their pickup truck parked in their driveway, and they had the back end of the pickup truck opened. And so their son was playing, so he climbed up in the back of the pickup truck and was playing in the back of the pickup truck, and then he wanted to get down, and as he walked over to the edge, it was too far to jump, so he didn't want to jump off, and he was going to sit down on his rear and scoot off, but his feet were too short, so he was kind of scared to do that. So I don't know if you've ever done this before. He turned and got on his belly, and he started to get his way off so that he could get his feet on the ground, but the problem was his legs were too short, and so he found himself kind of on his belly on the back end of that truck, teetering back and forth because his feet couldn't touch the ground. And so he thought, I'm going to go help my son. So he walked over to help him. He says he walked over to the truck. He could hear his 4-year-old son saying to himself out loud, somebody help the boy. Somebody help the boy. I've always remembered that story because I think there's some truth to that. You may feel like, hey, life has been crazy. You know, there's all this stuff coming at me. You may feel like you're teetering. You're unsure what to do, where to go next. You have anxiety. You're fearful about life, maybe fearful about death. I would just remind you this Christmas, you have hope. And it's found in this Christ child, the baby in a manger. Listen, today you can bring your doubts to him because he is the assurance that God keeps his promise. Maybe you have feelings of despair. You can bring it to him because he conquered the grave. And even in death, you can find hope. So as we kind of wrap this up, I would just say, listen, the greatest gift you can receive is Christ as your Savior. And so if you are watching online, in fact, one thing you'll notice is that if you have any questions about how to receive Christ, how to have a relationship with this Christ child, you can feel free. In fact, it'll come up on the screen. You can text us at Olivet BC to 81010. Maybe you have some specific prayer needs, prayer concerns. You can text us at Olivet Pray to 81010. Don't go through this Christmas season and miss the Christ of Christmas. He is our hope. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your presence here with us. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us in Christ. And Father, we thank you that as we enter this Christmas season at a very unusual year, you are our foundation. You are our strength. You offer hope. So, Lord, I pray that each of us would turn our hearts, lives, minds, all that we are over to you. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.